Shall he look to God in prayer? Lord God, we thank you for this afternoon. We thank you for these ministerial assistants who have trained, equipped themselves to be commissioned in your church. Lord, even now as I share the word, may the Spirit of God speak to me so that I can speak to them. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. First of all, let me apologize for coming late for this program. 3 o'clock was the program, but because of the other commitments, my time was delayed. And I'm sure that from morning 10 o'clock, morning when I left, I saw some of you here. And you know, from morning you've been here. And I know that, you know, after a heavy lunch, you may not be willing to listen to a long discourse or a long message. But if I don't speak to you today, I may not be able to speak to you again. So let me take this time to speak to you. I'm so happy that, you know, so many of you are wearing this white cassock and the white girdle. And you know, when I look at the pastors with black girdle and the stole, very soon you are going to replace them. But what is this ministerial assistance is all about? Never in the history or never in the diocese you can replace a pastor. But you are under the control, under the instruction, under the guidance, under the valued leadership of the pastors. Never ever think, no, because I'm wearing the same cassock and the same girdle like the pastors, I am far above than the pastors. Pastors are ordained. You are commissioned. Pastors have a role to play. You have very limited role to play. Last time also in 2018, when I commissioned some people, I made myself very clear saying that from day one, we have been talking about the ministerial assistants and their responsibilities within the framework of the church. And if the local pastor wants you to make use of you, I think you should be willing to do that. And your roles is very limited within the four walls of your church. Unlike the pastors, you cannot be wearing the surplice and going around to market area and other places, which I have come to know. So as we commission you, these are some of the conditions that we put before you. And some of you commissioned people, you have also conducted engagement without the knowledge of the pastor, which is very much against your own commitment. So this evening, as I commission you on behalf of the pastors, it is my responsibility and sole responsibility to inform you that, you know, you have been chosen from among the many people and to be commissioned to help in the congregation. And you cannot go to the pastor and say, I want to preach. You can never do that. If the pastor invites you to preach, yes, you can go ahead and do it. Just because you are wearing the cassock or the angi, as you might call, it does not have any important positions in the church. You have volunteered yourself to come and commit yourself and your lives. And this does not guarantee that, you know, it gives you a different status altogether. This I said at the beginning of your tenure, and again I'm saying it. I especially want to thank Reverend Dr. Manoj Chandra Prasad. Although COVID-19 came, in spite of the pandemic, he was able to do online. The classes were conducted online. And you know, he was able to keep in touch along with the convener of the Nurture and Witness Committee, Reverend Timothy. So in all these pastors and the other resource persons, they have given the input that is required for you so that you'll be able to help the pastor in running the congregations. You have a definite role to play. On the coast of Norway was a lighthouse. Where the lighthouse was a lonely place by the side of the seashore, and there was a man and 2 children, and you know, for every provision he has to go across the other side of the shore to get the provisions. One evening it so happened that, you know, after the man left the house, There was such a big storm in the sea, he could not come back in the night. The sister and the brother thought for a while and looked at the lighthouse and said, "It is such a tall building, we need to climb up." Because gone are the days where they used to light up the light so that the ships will not come and hit against the lighthouse. Thereby, the brother and the sister said, "We will climb up the ladder, we go like daddy, and we light up the lamp there." When they climbed up, they found out themselves, no, that lamp which is kept, the wick was quite higher than they can think of. So the little Johnny said, "Akka, you come on to my shoulder, and I will hold you, you climb up, and you light the candle, light the lamp." As the sister was trying to light the lamp, the brother was holding the sister, and the sister asked the brother, "Does it hurt you? Because I'm older to you. Does it hurt you?" "Of course it hurts, but keep the light burning. Keep the light burning." And that is the challenge for all of us. Lighting a candle is easy. Lighting a lamp is easy. Getting commissioned is easy. Let the light shine. While Jesus was living in this world, he said, "Let the light shine before men, that they will see your good works, and then they will praise my heavenly Father." So my dear friend, this evening, as you light up yourself, many dreams, many plans, you will have many things. But you know, the brother said, "It hurts me. It hurts me because I'm holding on such a big lock, because you are heavier than me. But you know, although it is hurting me, let the light shine." And that would be one of the important aspects that a ministerial assistant should be willing to do it. Submitting God's will and God's purposes. Fulfilling it to the fullest. It is not today that you wear a new cassock, come and get commissioned and then go back. It is allowing God to intervene in your life. And someone said, God's plan is something that you discover, not something you decide. Many a times we plan everything and say, "This is God's will." My dear friends, God's will is something that you discover and not you decide. I'm sure that you'll make the difference between these two words. God's will for you that you need to discover, or you should need to unravel the mystery as you walk through your faith journey. 40 years ago, I took the Word of God in my hand. It's going to be 40 years since the Word of God is carrying me wherever I go, because I've been sincere and faithful to the Word of God. It is not just carrying the ordination, or it is not just carrying the commission. It is allowing the light to shine. Allow God to unveil the will of God in each of your lives. When I listen, God speaks. Every experience that you go through is a learning process. Although it is 40 years since I took the ministry, but still today also I'm learning. Every time I open the Bible, God speaks to me. But you know, do I have the willingness to listen to God's voice? It is because many a times I feel, or many of us feel, I have got it already. What else to study? My dear friends, it is not your age. It is not your experience. It is not the knowledge that you have. God speaks to us if only you are willing to listen. Remember Samuel. First time God calls, he didn't listen. He didn't understand. He goes to the prophet and says, "Did you wake me up?" Second time God calls, he didn't understand. Only third time, "Here am I, your servant. Speak to me." God is willing to speak to us, provided we are willing to listen. In James chapter 1 and chapter 5, verse 5, "If any of you lack wisdom, he should ask God, who gives generously to all without finding fault, and it will be given to him." If any of you lack wisdom, last week was the teacher's day. And you know, everywhere we talked about wisdom, we talked about Jesus the Guru, we talked about how Jesus was able to impart teaching to the people whom we listen to. And you know, if you are going to say that the wisdom is from above, if you lack wisdom, Ask God and He will give you. I will know what I need when I need to know it. If you are committed to do God what God tells you, then you will be able to see through it. Because obedience to God can overcome the obstacles that you face. The obedience to God, you'll be able to overcome the obstacles that you need to face. God knows what you should require and when you should require. Then you'll be able to understand. There are three little words that I would like to leave with you this evening. Number one, consistently surrendering to Lord's leadership. It is in consistency that you'll be able to understand. It is not emotional. One day you're emotionally charged, so you go say hallelujah to one corner, and tomorrow everything goes down, then you come back to the original place. No. There should be consistency in your prayer life. There should be consistency in the reading of the word. There should be consistency in whatever you say and do. Because God has elevated you to a different occasion, to a different position altogether. Consistency, surrendering. Apostle Paul says, it is not that I have accomplished. I still press on towards a goal. Still pressing on. I forget the past. Pressing on towards a goal that God has kept for me. And ultimately, it is consistency, it is surrendering. And thirdly, surrendering to the leadership of God. No human beings. Surrendering to the leadership of God, then you'll be able to see how vibrant you can become, how fruitful your ministry would be, and how you'll be able to really understand God's ways. God's unchanging purposes in His call. If you and I feel that God has called you, He has called you to different vocation. He called somebody as engineer, somebody as lawyer, somebody as doctor, somebody as teachers, somebody as ministerial assistant, somebody as pastors. God's call is variety of calls according to your vocation. At the same time, if God calls you, and if you understand the purpose for which God has called you, and you'll be able to really be a fruitful person. God calls men and women to His unchanging purpose. I can quote many examples. Call of Abraham. Call of Abraham was an obedient call by Abraham because he said, God told that all the peoples of the earth would be blessed by you. One man obeys, the whole generation gets a blessing. The call of Moses in Exodus chapter 3. I have indeed seen the misery of my people. Their groaning has come to my ears. Their cry I can hear. Moses, I am choosing you. Purposeful call. I will give you the land with milk and honey to Abraham. Purposeful call. Call God calls movements to His unchanging purposes. This year is 75th anniversary of the Church of South India Formation Day. And now 75 years, this particular church has been progressively moving. It's not a static church that all of us understand. It has been moving because it has been fulfilling the purpose for which God has initiated this particular church. From the first reading from the book of Jeremiah, chapter 1, God gave the prophet Jeremiah one of the most undesirable tasks that could be asked of a man. And his task was, go deliver God's message to a people who will not listen. God knows that, you know, people will not listen. In spite of God knowing people will not listen, God said, told Jeremiah, go and speak. For 40 years, he served as God's spokesman to Judah. Nobody listened. But God told Jeremiah, I have chosen you. You will go and you will speak. Many a times, my dear friends, you may not see the results. Your job is to sow the seeds and you go forward. It is for God to give the growth. You may not see the harvest, but you sow the seed. Seeds of kindness, seeds of compassion, seeds of forgiveness, seeds of reconciliation, seeds of love, and you sow all the seeds. And at the end of the day, you move on. 1 Corinthians chapter 3. Somebody plowed the ground, somebody sowed the seed, somebody watered it, but it is God who gives the growth. As ministerial assistants, your job is to sow the seeds. Don't turn back. Sow your seeds and move forward. God gives you the growth. In everything that we do, that God gives you the growth. Three encouraging words to this young Jeremiah. Do not say, I'm only a youth. Do not say, I don't know to speak. Do not give excuses when God calls you. Now I take it for granted that God has called you to this particular occasion and he has given you this responsibility of being the ministerial assistant. If that is the situation, do not escape from the responsibilities that your pastors would give you in the future. Jeremiah's life is rooted in the purposes of God, because God tells Jeremiah, even before you were formed in the womb of your mother, I have chosen you. So God's purposes are predestined, preordained. So here is a place where God tells Jeremiah, even before you were formed in the womb of your mother, I have chosen you. Do not get discouraged. I knew you because you are my own. God says, I have consecrated you. Before you were born, I consecrated you. Set him apart for this special holy purpose. If you feel that God has chosen you for a special particular purpose, today is the time. And God appointed Jeremiah to be a prophet where people will not accept him, where people will not accept his ideology, people will not accept the good news, people will not accept him as a human being, because he was condemning sins of Judah. A good ministerial assistant can be one of the greatest blessings to a local church. And the local church will enjoy your ministry. In my memory, I can tell from Haynes Road, some of the older people who were just lay preachers those days, they went out of their building, like Reverend Reuben Jacob, who was ordained later as a pastor. And today, big churches are standing. It is because of that lay preachers who were able to go and work elsewhere. It is not all the time within the altar. It is not all the time within your church. History says, these lay preachers, when I mentioned Reverend Reuben Jacob, he was working in the government press in Bangalore. After he's finishing his job, he used to just go and help congregations. And because of him, there is a huge congregation everywhere. So God can make use of you if only you are willing. If you are going to get into the politics of the diocese, and if you are going to say, I'm going to be here, I need preaching, I need only the preaching part of it, then it's going to be a very difficult one. So a lay preacher or a ministerial assistant possesses the ability to support. He has the ability to support. He has the ability to build. He has the ability to divide and tear it down. It is in your hands. That's why this year when we planned to have the elections for the pastorate committee, we made it very clear that, you know, if you want to be in the part of your governance, you cannot be part of the ministerial assistance. And so many of them came to my room and gave the letter saying that we do not want to be ministerial assistants, we want to be in the governance. It is their choice. My dear friends, today's Christians' influence. How are you influencing people around you? From today onwards, people are going to look at you from a different perspective altogether. Once upon a time, you were one among the pews. You were seated along with them. But today, you seem to have a different position and different responsibility altogether. How people are going to see you? There are two things that we value that seem so insignificant, but part of our survival. One is either we complain too much of these, or we say we want more of these. Two things are very important. Either you complain too much of this, or you say too little of this. One is hardly seen, the other one is visible. And Jesus used these examples, the light and the salt. One is hardly seen, but it is visible. The salt, when it dissolves, you can't see it, but you can only taste it. Jesus said, "You are the salt and the light." Moving away from that passage to Matthew's Gospel, chapter 16, I would like to draw your attention to this particular confession. The word confession would mean talking about confession in the sense of a formal statement of essential doctrinal truth. But normally, confession would mean an admission. Confession would mean I've admitted the guilt that I've committed. But you know, here, when Peter is confessing, he is confessing the doctrinal truth that Jesus is the Christ. So we call this as a blessed confession. As ministerial candidates, now you'll be ministerial assistants, when you go and preach, is it the confession that you're going to make? That I believe in this, so I speak. If you don't believe in this, please don't speak. And that is where your reality, that is where your honesty, that is where your neatness comes very handy. This is one of the crucial, most crucial passages in the gospel. Now, this confession was first uttered at an important juncture in Jesus' earthly ministry. When was this made? There was so much of hatred for people when the Pharisees and the Sadducees saw Jesus Christ becoming more popular and popular. And they wanted the way to kill Jesus Christ. And you know, Jesus is taking his disciples from this shore, and he's saying he got into the boat and he's going to the other side of the shore. While they are on the other side of the shore, Jesus is asking these disciples, "Who do you say that I am?" Everybody said, "You're a prophet, you're a king, you're a miracle worker." So many things they said. But here is one man, Peter. He said, "You are the Christ." And Jesus immediately said, "The flesh and the blood has not revealed it, but my Father in heaven has revealed," which means to say, "Peter, what you said was right. You are declaring that you are the Messiah. You are declaring that you are the Christ who came down to this world." My dear friends, this evening, St. Peter's confession of faith. To confess one's faith is to publicly admit. Many a times, even you have a Christian name, you do not want to accept a Christian name. When you want to give children Christian names, you want to give a neutral name, because we do not want to confess that we are Christians. What will the others think if I am going to confess that I am a Christian? As ministerial candidates, you need to teach. And Jesus also said, there's a slight difference in that Greek language. Jesus said, "I will build on this rock." He never meant Peter to be the rock. Two different words are used for the stone there. Peter, which means rock. It is good to note that as we hear Jesus saying, "And I also say to you that you are Peter, on this rock I will build my church." And we are able to see the difference how Jesus was able to make. He didn't say that Peter, Petros, the rock on you. No, it was not on Peter that the church has been built, but it has been built on the rock on which Jesus becomes the foundation. It is not sermons, but your lifestyle. That's exactly what we want to tell you this evening. I have chosen you even before you were formed in the womb. And the angel of the Lord brought a coal and kept it on the mouth, signifying consecration, setting apart, purifying, making you holy. Your confession has to be open. Clarity should be there in your confession. And what you believe, you need to really confess. Then it is not your sermons, it is your lifestyle that is going to make an impact in the lives and in the minds of people. H.M. Stanley went to Africa in 1871 to find a report about David Livingstone. I'm sure all of us know David Livingstone. He spent several months with David Livingstone trying to find out whether David Livingstone would preach the gospel to him. After many years of staying with him, H.M. Stanley writes saying, he could not understand how the missionary could have such love for the and patience with a backward pagan people. Livingstone literally spent himself in untiring service for those whom he had no reason to love except for Christ's sake. Stanley wrote in his journal, when I saw that unwearied patience, that unflagging zeal, and those enlightened sons of Africa, I became a Christian at his side, though he never spoke to me one word. H.M. Stanley was also a person who was always close with many of our Christian leaders during the British regime here in our country. And he writes in his memoir saying, David Livingstone never spoke a word, but looking at his lifestyle, I have become a Christian. It is not in preaching. It is not in teaching. It is not in your attitude. It is how you are going to conduct yourself within your own church circles, within your own pastor circles, within your own self. Then you will have a lot of problems. You will face challenges. Peter denied Jesus Christ. He forsook Jesus Christ. And he also left Jesus Christ and went away, back to fishing. But Jesus calls him and saying, do you love me more than this? And he said, yes, Lord, you know it. So today is a time you are going to say, Lord, I want to confess you, but you know my heart. You know my intentions. You know my attitude. Help me, O Lord, that I might be like Isaiah. I might be like Jeremiah. People may not accept me, but I want you to touch me and make me your own. Then we'll be able to say, this service, the training, the equipping, everything becomes more useful for the congregations and for the churches because you have been chosen. You have been set apart. You are what you are because God has called you for a greater service. Let us pray. Lord God, we thank you and we humble before your throne of grace. We are nothing in ourselves. You make us everything because we surrender our lives into your care. We thank you for these 81 candidates who have been trained, for the training that has gone on, and for all the inputs that they have taken. And now, Lord, as they go into the congregation, exhibiting Christ-likeness, exhibiting all that you have taught them, may they be humble, may they be mindful of God's love, may they reciprocate God's forgiveness, may they reconcile with one another. And we ask you, Lord, that you will bless them, bless the hands that's going to keep it on their heads. We ask you that this commissioning would bring in changes, would bring in reformation, renovation, and all that is required for the church to grow. And so, Lord, we commit them. Give them your blessings. It is not in us. It is in you. For we ask this prayer in Jesus' name. Amen.